Now we're really pushing it. Out of all of the upcoming projects that Marvel had in the works, this was the one that I was the least excited about. Even before Edgar Wright jumped ship, I always thought that Ant-Man was just ridiculous, even by Marvel standards. I mean, what does he do? Raid picnics? The fact that he was the subject of many a Riff Tracks joke didn't really help.
Whatever happens tomorrow, you must promise me one thing.
Don't let Ant-Man become an Avenger.
However, if there's one thing that nature has taught us, it's that size isn't everything. So could this movie have a chance? Well, let's find out by looking at Ant-Man. The film begins in 1989. Scientist Hank Pym has invented a piece of technology that decreases the distance between molecules while increasing physical strength, earning him the name Ant-Man. Not wanting it to fall in the wrong hands, he buries his research and vows to hide it from the rest of the world. Unfortunately, in the present, Pym's former protege, Darren Cross, is close to replicating the technology in a new suit called the Yellow Jacket. Fearing the consequences, Pym recruits recently released thief Scott Lang and tasks him with infiltrating Cross's company, wiping out his research, and stealing the Yellow Jacket. To do this, Lang must learn to harness the power of Pym's old suit and become the new Ant-Man. Now, first of all, Paul Rudd is one of the last people I ever expected to play a superhero. But in a way, that's oddly fitting. Ant-Man at first glance seems pretty unimpressive, so it's kind of appropriate. With that said, Rudd is excellent here, possessing an everyman charm that makes him one of the more relatable heroes in the Marvel pantheon. Not only does he show off some great comedic timing and charisma, but he also brings plenty of emotional weight and verisimilitude to the role. He does a brilliant job of balancing heartfelt drama and self-aware humor, and I honestly can't think of anyone else that I would rather have in the part. His personal conflict involving his family isn't exactly original, but his charm ultimately outweighs the feeling of familiarity. The same can be said for Michael Douglas. He lends such a weathered gravitas and sarcastic wit to Hank Pym that you buy every single fantastical concept that comes out of his mouth. You can sense a deep regret in his demeanor, but there's also a fierce determination that makes him more than just your standard mentor figure. Then we have his daughter Hope. She's a little spiteful at first, sure, but she's also intelligent and proactive. Her emotional turmoil is offset by a believable inner strength, and Evangeline Lilly beautifully conveys this with a complex and endearing performance. Oddly enough, one of the elements that I was most concerned about here was the villain. I don't have anything against Corey Stoll, are you kidding me? The guy's great on the strain. It's just that Marvel films, especially the ones in Phase 2, tend to have some pretty boring bad guys. Cross's personal history with Pym gives him a bit more depth than someone like Obadiah Stane, but his impact is somewhat diminished by the fact that he's yet another evil businessman looking to make a profit. Because we haven't seen that before. Fortunately, Stoll's charismatic cruelty lends itself well to some occasional gallows humor that's admittedly entertaining. However, this pales in comparison to the likes of David Desmalchin, T.I. Harris, and especially Michael Peña as the members of Lang's crew. I didn't even think I was gonna like them, but they were hilarious. They play well off of each other, they have great comedic timing, I couldn't get enough of them. What additionally helps is that they're not overused, they're not forced into the plot when there's nothing for them to do. Speaking of that, the story, for the most part, is told fairly well, maintaining a steadily brisk pace without ever feeling rushed. The father-daughter dynamic adds a bit of thematic weight to the whole piece. Sadly though, the narrative takes some time to really find its feet. The storytelling in the first act is pretty clunky. In trying to rapidly introduce all of the seemingly unrelated concepts and characters, the movie just comes off as a series of isolated scenes that don't flow into each other. They're kind of amusing on their own, but after a while, I was wondering when the real plot was going to start. In addition, the film occasionally jumps between tones, immediately going from a comedic montage to an emotional argument without any transition. In spite of these issues though, there's an overriding sense of mischievous fun that makes the experience worthwhile. The filmmakers know that this is a silly premise, and it's this sense of self-awareness that paves the way for the comedy. This is a very funny flick that also functions as a fairly exciting heist film, which is actually what makes it so refreshing. While the past few Marvel films have been pretty heavy on huge action set pieces and world-threatening conflicts, this one is noticeably smaller in scope, which couldn't be more appropriate for the surprisingly appealing title character. This film makes Ant-Man look like a pretty cool superhero. Seeing his suit in action, as well as how he can use different types of ants to his advantage, is genuinely interesting. The sequences where he shrinks are exhilarating, with the impressive visual effects making even the most boring objects look massive. On top of that, these scenes also feature some creatively adventurous direction by Peyton Reed. All of this is additionally complemented by Christoph Beck's energetic musical score. Overall, Ant-Man may suffer from some initially clumsy storytelling, a few issues in tone, and a lack of originality in some areas, but it ultimately transcends these problems with its charming performances, witty humor, dazzling effects, upbeat atmosphere, and a belief in the idea that you don't always have to go bigger in order to be better. Thanks for watching, feel free to like, subscribe, and/or comment. Until next time.